Hey yo, from the Kingdom of Ohio, you are listening to OCCULTURE, where the body has been occulted all winter long, and now we're finally ready to show it off. Well, maybe not quite yet. Give it a few weeks still. We're doing that whole ketogenic thing. Or maybe we're plant-based now. I don't know. It's hard to keep track of what diet we're on these days. Anyways, I am your host, Ryan Peverly. Welcome to the show. Thanks for dropping by. And what a conversation we have in store for you this time around. Alkistis Dimech is in the house. You know her, you love her. She's the co-founder of Scarlet Imprint, perhaps the finest occult publishing house going today. But Alkistis is so much more than that. She's a dancer and choreographer and a student of music and theater and the arts. She also kinda sorta took me to task on Twitter not too long ago, and rightly so. And, well, you'll hear about that too, right up front here, actually. So, enough prologue. Let's flip this script to dialogue and inject that third eye with another dose of that consciousness-enhancing audio. Enjoy. Alkistis Dimech, thanks for being here.
Thank you for asking me.
No problem. I have been a fan of yours and your... Is Peter your partner? Like, I don't know how to describe your relationship to... Yeah.
Lover, accomplice.
Accomplice. That's probably a better term. Yeah. I've been a fan of you guys for a while now. We'll talk more about Scarlet Imprint a little later in the conversation, probably. You know, normally I would begin on a personal note, you know, introduce you to the part of the audience who's unfamiliar with your work, you know, talk a bit about how you got to this point in your journey, things of that sort. But I'm not going to do that. Instead, we're going to start with a tweet, because that's really what prompted this call in the first place. So, back in episode 68 of this podcast, I had a bit of a Jack Parsons and Philip K. Dick roundtable with three other folks. They happened to be men, and of course, the subject of the goddess Babalon came up, as it will, with Jack Parsons. And after listening to the podcast, you tweeted this. You said, "Enjoyed this, but still a solely male perspective, especially, I noticed, regarding the language of creation." And that is a fair criticism. It was a solely male perspective. And I'd love for you to elaborate further on that criticism, if you don't mind, you know, especially as it relates to that last bit, the language of creation. What did we get right in that conversation? What did we get wrong? What did we miss?
Well, I enjoyed the conversation. I especially like listening to Erick talking about Jack Parsons, because I can't imagine anybody better to talk about that magical landscape that Jack lived in and that particular history in California. So that's fascinating. And I really interested in his later discussion as well at the end of the podcast, where he's talking about the sort of the disenchantment with the digital. So that was all very, very interesting. It was just somewhere around like the middle. I think it was Miguel who said, he kind of laughed and joked and observed that, it's like four dudes talking about Babalon. And I have no problem at all with men talking about the divine feminine. And it's just that a male perspective only on that is limited. It's just one half of the reality. So it was really about that, especially when men are talking about things. It's not always that and it's the same for women. Like, you don't know what it's like from the other side. So it's simply that. But it's very hard, I think, for men to appreciate how much society, culture has been shaped by men without the input of like women. So their perspective has been really missed, and is still like missing from magic, I find, overall. I'm thinking in terms of a lot of my work. I work with the sort of the lunar cycle and the menstrual cycle. So this is my hormonal rhythm. This is the female hormonal rhythm. It's like the estrogen changes over the course of a month. The male hormonal rhythm is much faster. It's like a diurnal. It's over 24 hours. And it's, you know, it peaks in the morning. That's when the testosterone is highest. And it sort of gradually goes down by the end of the day. And it responds to other stimulus like violence or sexual imagery will also cause testosterone to peak. So this kind of energy that fuels male creativity is based around a different cycle and a different kind of sense, a different sense of being in the world. And my sense of being in the world is a different rhythm. And this sense of the shape of time changes. So it's just this, when I'm working, for example, on my dance or writing or whatever I'm doing, I'm thinking in terms of these longer cycles and of this relationship with my body and the moon and the environment that's connected. I'm not sure how much men think like that.
Probably not at all, to be honest.
It was just that I found noticeably missing from the conversation when it was talking about the divine feminine, because the feminine for men is like an idea, an image, an other. And it can be very evocative, but the reality of being that other to men, I mean, for me, men is the other, so, but the reality of being and working and living and creating as a woman is sort of alien to male experience. And so when talking about these things, it's missing from their language. And that's just all I noticed.
So when I think of the divine feminine, I probably have a very rudimentary approach to it. I think of more of like coming into touch or into tune with, you know, like my own sort of emotional aspects. But it's got to be a lot deeper and more complex than that, right?
The divine, I mean, it's lots of things. It's many, many things. I think if I'm going to be more specific and talk more about what Babalon is for me, because that podcast was about Jack and Babalon and that aspect of the divine feminine, and I'm not qualified to talk about all aspects of that. I haven't experienced motherhood, for example, and there are other, and I'm like 44 at the moment, so I haven't experienced like the old age yet. So there are many aspects of the divine feminine that I can't talk about or haven't experienced anyway. But the things that are very interesting to me about Babalon, I haven't seen really put forward particularly. I mean, I know Peter has put some of these ideas in his work because we work very closely together, and his like apocalyptic witchcraft and Lucifer, which has some hidden Babalon material in it, are informed by our joint work. So it's more balanced in my opinion. It's just that there are so many mysteries to this goddess that aren't at the forefront of the way people think about her. So for example, yeah, if I get back to Revelations, Revelation is really important to the way I understand her, much more so than Crowley, who I don't resonate with his work at all. But she's described as the mother of harlots and abominations of the earth. This is a very interesting phrase if you understand, if you kind of dismantle and look at it. I did a work last summer, and it was the decollation of flowers, and I was dedicating it to my mother and examining through the figure of the young girl, Salome, this relationship with the mother, and how, for example, it is something very interesting, the way that the mother imprints her erotic and sexual nature onto her children. So her experience of the world, the mother's eroticism is given to the child through touch. So through nurture, touch, through being so close to her. So I wanted to explore my identity through what I'd inherited from my mother, through what she'd given me through her body, both genetically and epigenetically. So when I read Revelation and I read that she's the mother of harlots and the abominations of the earth, I understand that the harlot or the holy whore is something that's coming from this goddess, that this eroticism is something that she's molded and nurtured and created. It's all of these erotic arts are coming from this goddess through this matrilineal inheritance. And I can get into the abominations, but we understand that in terms of she's the goddess that stands above these exogamous relationships between angels and the human women that create the giants and, you know, bring about the fall. So for me, the goddess stands at the head of the angelic and the demonic tradition, and also the tradition of like the secrets of carnal knowledge, the secrets that are tied to the eroticism, especially as passed from mother to daughter through their bodies.
Yeah,
does that make sense?
Yeah, it makes complete sense. And I have some questions around that, actually. But I do want to tell you that I watched that decollation of flowers.
Yeah,
I watched that last night, actually. It's on your website. It's about an 8-minute performance piece, you know, with your dance. And I really enjoyed it. And it's the first time I actually sat down and tried to absorb some of your performance. And I thought it blew me away. You describe it as erotic. And I thought it was, you know, I didn't know if that was me, you know, maybe just being too much in the masculine while I was watching it. But I really thought that was a pretty erotic piece. So it was nice that I picked up on that, I guess, without knowing what exactly you were trying to communicate. But back to what you were talking about with Babalon, you know, one thing that I am curious about is the paradox of forms that she embodies. You know, I think you sort of touched on that. We've seen it described as ambiguity incarnate, you know, beauty and terror, creation and destruction. What does this tell us about the nature of her power and what it may mean for us if we're trying to work with her?
I think if we look at sexuality honestly and don't try and impose a morality on it, if we understand like this sexual drive is also a drive that destroys as well as creates, and that it's incredibly dangerous in this sense. It's something that you have to master. It's something that you have to come to terms with, not suppress, not restrain in these sort of artificial morality, like codes of morality and so on. But you have to find a way to accept that this exists in men and women both, and that there are different sexualities, and that they may take many kinds of expression. The expression may change throughout the life, throughout the month, throughout the week, throughout the day. I mean, it's like fire. It has it's something which is both can be used to create. It's the same energy that you create children with that you also use to put into any creative or artistic work. So it's part of, it's this, but it's also got a dark side to it as well. A destructive, and it can be turned to use in a bad way, to turn against people, to control people. I mean, one of the most obvious ways that people are controlled is through their sexuality, through shaming or through trying to impose particular codes of behavior on people that aren't really in tune with our genetics, our genetic history anyway. Both men and women too, I find, are controlled through this. Mm-hmm. And with patriarchy, it's like men getting a very bad rap at the moment, but most men are victims of patriarchy too. Patriarchy only seems to serve a few, like, you know, alpha males at the top of the pile that get everything. But everybody's been enslaved to this political system.
So does Babalon, throughout history, does she sort of come through stronger at certain points? Like maybe when the patriarchy sort of ramps up to the next level, she comes in to sort of balance that out?
I don't know, patriarchy might be ramping up because she's coming back and it's feeling threatened. It can go both ways. But she seems to make her appearance at crisis, points of crisis, critical moments historically. I think the work Dee and Kelly did with the angelic language and these conversations with the angels, it shows that she, this is like after Revelation, she's really most present in this work of Dee and Kelly. And Dee's intention was to renew the book of nature, to somehow, like, he felt that they were at a critical moment historically, that the apocalypse was, you know, about to take place and everything end, and it was like, we have to communicate with the angels and find a way to renew. And she comes through as the daughter of fortitude. And I think there's something similar that happened with Jack in California, that it was, you know, it's just, it presaged the new age. It just before, you know, feminism, the new age, all of these things, the ecological, environmental movements, you know, really exploded. So, I mean, Jack is very interesting for this aspect to him, irrespective of, you know, any limitations to his own channeling work or his own kind of version of feminism. I think he's still a very, very important and interesting figure for having these visions. But I think crisis is something very much related to her. And revolution, in the sense that revolution is tied to the female body, not in a kind of cataclysmic sense necessarily, but in simply that the body's always changing, like the monthly period, you go through revolutions, and it's this continual renewal. And this is, I think you can say that a matriarchal culture would be based around a continual renewal like this, and one that's not chained to industrial or digital time, which are very artificial and very damaging to the body.
I want to go back to that paradox just for a moment, because Babalon seems to pair well with the Greek god Eros. You actually wrote an essay about the same topic. Eros reconciles opposites while holding them in perpetual opposition, is what you said about that. And we know that Babalon and Eros could very well be the same figure or force, maybe. And that similarity also extends to this almost insatiable, you know, sexuality, this thirst that can never really be quenched. And that seems to be, to me, at least, like, that seems to be like a masculine trait, like lust or maybe even greed on some level, you know, seeking this power. But if Babalon is reconciling opposites, she should be embodying these masculine traits as well, right?
She does. And even if you look to Inanna Ishtar, Mesopotamian incarnation of this goddess, this force, she's often described in very male terms. She has a very male approach to her lovers. You know, she loves them and then kills them or leaves them. You know, they don't fare well. She just like takes what she wants, enjoys, and moves on. She's not constrained or held back by any idea of the way women should behave. But I also have this, men have an idea like maybe what they want female sexuality to be like, or I think female sexuality is very, very complex. And of course, every woman is her own thing, is everyone expresses it differently, so I can't even generalize about that. But the insatiableness is much more connected with women's sexuality than men in that sense. Men, yes, power, and men, you know, man can I mean, the male organ works, that it's strong, it's erect, and then it's not, and it has to like wait a time to come back. But women are capable of having sex without like having to wait. It's possibility. It, not maybe they want to. But what I'm kind of getting to is that we have a relationship to sex that we've not, that's been forbidden for hundreds, for thousands of years. This sort of, oh, you must marry one man. Marriage I don't find particularly feminist. It's an economic structure based on, you know, a small unit, and the woman works for the man while the man goes and gets a job. It's kind of, it's outmoded in those ways. It's not, for me, it's not a sacred union. It's a political expediency. This, I don't know, I have more to say about this, but it's just very complicated.
I would agree with you. I mean, marriage is not a holy union these days. And, you know, you mentioned Mesopotamia and Inanna Ishtar. I especially like this quote from Gilgamesh in this essay you wrote, where he essentially rejects the goddess. You know, he says, "And what will happen to me when your heart turns elsewhere and your lust burns out? Which of your husbands did you love forever? Which could satisfy your endless desires?" Well, that sounds like Gilgamesh maybe embodying some of those feminine aspects too, you know? Like, do you think that quote specifically may speak to the goddess's influence or power over him if she's reconciling opposites? Like, is that her balancing out Gilgamesh in that instance?
I don't think Gilgamesh is a very good example of like a typical man anyway. He was monster. Yeah. I mean, I hated him. He was like a tyrant. He was killing people and laying waste to cities. So he's like an out of control alpha male that, you know, all the beta males join forces with the women and get rid of, you know, one night. He's not a good example. And I don't think he's typical man. I don't know. I've had such a good friendships with men, very supportive. And I don't find that these stereotypes of male or female sexuality are very like real in, you know, men are also emotional creatures. Men also want emotional contact. And some of the ideas imposed by, I don't know, the patriarchal society about what men and women are and what they should expect from life are wrong anyway. But I wanted to get back to this idea of female sexuality. It's not just like an endless lust, like just, you know, sex, sex, sex and nothing but it's an eroticism. It's a sensuality. And they do some studies. It's kind of interesting. And this is why I think that the goddess of sex and sexuality and eroticism is female and not male, even though I think she stands for like the eroticism that lives in all men and all women and animals and, you know, plants, everything. This desire to keep becoming and fusing. There was a study, and it was to find out, they monitor like your heart, your eyes, the testing by watching a pornography, what people respond to. And they found, for example, this is interesting, that men respond sexually only to the thing that they're sexually interested in. So like generally women or men if they're gay. Women respond sexually. They get an erotic response to everything. They can watch, you know, anything and get a sexual response from it. And this is what I found. You know, I remember years and years ago joking that like everything's an aphrodisiac because, you know, I could get turned on by anything, you know, some sensation. And, you know, I'm already like thinking about sex. So I don't think it's because I'm a nymphomaniac. I think it's just because a female responds to the environment, to the imagination in a very, you know, in a sensual way. And it's this rather than like just raw lust, appetite, power. You know, it's connected, but there's also this aspect, the sensual aspect, which gets forgotten. It's also very important. And this is also what I'm trying to get to when I was saying earlier about how the Whore of Babalon is described as the mother of harlots. She's the mother of them because she's imprinted on women their erotic natures. And this is what we're feeling in our bodies. It's this sense of the holy whore in us, this pure eroticism, this ability to be one and fuse with everything in nature simply because we have that open erotic response to it. It doesn't have to be consummated in sex.
Yeah, you know, I might be really in touch with that force then, because the way you described, you know, the aphrodisiac stuff that you were talking about, yeah, I'm pretty much the same way. So I'm also a Scorpio, so, you know, take that for what it's worth. So do we all have our own Scarlet Woman maybe then? Like, I read somewhere where, it might have been something you wrote or someone else wrote, but I was reading about how there are daughters of Babalon just incarnating all the time, essentially. And that just made me think, like, does everybody have that sort of role in their life? Do we all encounter a Scarlet Woman at some point?
It would be a shame not to, wouldn't it?
Well, yeah.
I don't think there's one woman incarnating Babalon. I think that Babalon is an erotic and sensual and revolutionary force that comes through people. But it's particularly incarnated in a feminine, because that's also what's been so, well, I mean, for the reasons I've been talking about this sort of the characteristics of female sexuality or female relationship to the environment, which I don't think that it's something that men can't experience or don't have. I just think that it's something that patriarchy has written out of their stories. It's not convenient. You don't make money. There is an economic conversation that needs to take place, because patriarchy and capitalism are so closely tied together, and and is sort of there in Christianity as well, you know, in the Bible, where God says to Adam and Eve, you know, here you have everything in the garden, you know, it's yours, do what you want with it. And that becomes used as an excuse later to, like, take what we want from the earth without a sense that we're somehow destroying our own body through this process of greed.
You have a quote here too that I pulled out of one of your essays. You wrote that, "I propose that her mythic corpus is still being written, and that it will be written through and by the body first before it finds expression in language." And I really like your language there, and it pairs well with another idea you've written about that does, this all ties in, right? But this idea of the occulted body, or the dynamics of the occulted body. What does that phrase occulted body mean exactly, and what are the dynamics of it?
Getting back to the first quote first, just to, because it ties in with this, it was really this idea that in order to find a new language, a new way to think and experience the world, or to see the world, or to form our relationship with it, we have to go back to the body and find, like, what languages can emerge from more intimate inquiry into it, into her mystery, into the body's mysteries. The occulted body for me is the body just as it is, you know, like we are sitting here. But it's those aspects of it that you don't see. So literally, it's like everything beneath the surface of the skin. It's like your insides, your bodily insides. It's your bones, your skeleton, your muscles, the viscera. It's your heart. It's your brain. It's like the very matter that you are. But for me, this matter is intelligent. It's sensible. It's sensuous. It knows. It knows before your brain, or it knows before you, like, rationally conceive something. I'm not going to talk about the brain, because it takes even more but the brain is a physical thing too. But it's precisely that this body already knows. And I think if you're, for example, a dancer, martial artists, anybody that has a skill, in fact, everybody has these skills. Everyone learns to write, for example. Writing's, like, handwriting is very difficult. You have to learn as a child, like, you know, complex ways of holding and moving the hand, like the physical capacity to do this. The same with any physical skill. And the more you do this, the more you repeat something, whichever skill this is, the more it becomes part of your instinct, the less you need to think about it. So the more it becomes something that sinks into the depths of you. And it's also something that can be passed on then. So this is, again, something that I was exploring in the decollation of flowers, in the work where I was trying to understand my female, in that piece particularly, my female line. It's, for example, my mother was a dancer. She trained as a ballet dancer. And I only decided to become a dancer very late in life, like at 28. And people just assumed I was a dancer before that because I have my mother's body. She gave me the body that she'd trained. It has, like, already got part of her that I carry with me. So it's like I understand that, and this is how genetics, epigenetics works. We inherit and pass on things through our bodies that we've done, and not just skills, but traumas, memories. I have some memories in my body of things I haven't experienced, but things that I know that I found out later had been experienced by my great-grandmother, for instance, is one thing. And this is kind of very interesting to me. So this is the knowledge that belongs to the occulted body. It's literally this, like, I guess you call it like the dark sense, this understanding of things because thousands of people have done it before you, and it's all there in your genetics and in your, like, in this body memory. Does that make sense to you?
Yeah, yeah. And, you know, this speaks to the work of Joseph Needham and Dr. Maiwan Ho, who you quoted in one of your essays when talking about this subject and talking about the liquid crystalline or crystalline structure of the living body. What can you tell us about their work and how it relates here?
This is why I was calling that essay The Dynamics of the Occulted Body, because this body is dynamic. It's we're mostly made of water. Our entire, like, structure is based on a liquid crystalline base. We're basically just giant crystals. It sounds really new age, but this is what we are. It's how we work. It's how this intelligence, I think, communicates, because everything has to be in resonance. Everything is in resonance, and it can be more in resonance. So I think if you, for example, if you do have some skill like dance, martial arts, and so on, you increasingly work on, like, making these things together. But it's just that I found Maiwan Ho's work fascinating because she looks at the dynamics of water, fluid dynamics, and there's a book by her called The Rainbow and the Worm that I think I would really recommend people to read. It's very scientific, but also quite readable. How she observed under the microscope, like, how this rainbow opened up inside this, like, a tiny specimen she was looking at, and it kind of gave her the understanding, and she worked out, like, oh, so we are made of water. We're completely made of water, but this water is, like, in tiny crystals. For me, this is, like, kind of the intelligence. This is the intelligence and the light and the fire in the body.
If that's the occulted body, then, all that you just described, how is that then revealed?
By everything we do. That's the kind of the joke, in a way, is simply that the occulted body is the bodies we have right with us that we can see, that we can feel. It's there, it's just that we don't see it. I get quite frustrated with some of the occult language that's used. And so also with this occulted body, it was a way to, like, get beyond some of these ideas that there's some kind of etheric body and it's, like, separate from us. For me, this is the body. And this occulted body is that esoteric body because it has all these things anyway. It has this. It's this that we're working. So, you know, the electromagnetic body is this. And it's that because we're made of liquid crystals and we're made of light and water, fire and water. It's what we are. And it's not something special that only special people have. It's something, yes, that we can cultivate and that we can consciously become more aware of. But it's also just what we are. It's what all humans are. It's what all creatures are. We have this in common. I think it's something I'm interested in, this commonality. You know, our genetic histories don't just extend back to being like early humans and the hominid, but to, you know, all of creation, all of the things that came before us. And I think you can find these forms in your body. You can find this cycle of life and early life in the body because we're all based on water. There's very interesting work by, recently died a few years ago, Emily Conrad. And she also talks a lot about this body. She was in Haiti. And she was dancing there and she had this experience with the Yanvalu, the wave, that, oh, this is it. This is everything. The sea and her were like one. And it's in the body. So her work was also, I found her work after I had written these things and was working also in my own body with waveforms and finding these waves. And she'd already been there and done it and created a body of work around this. And it's something that we all have. Again, it's not something that belongs just to women and to this, sort of this fluid femininity. It's in all bodies because it's our common heritage. We're all coming from the sea. We're all these creatures that the sea imagined at some point and then formed and then we crawled out of her. But we crawled out of her and we're still made of her. We're still made of the same. Our blood, the matter we're made of, is still the same as this primordial ocean. And because that's in us, we can find this fluidity in us. And this fluidity is also like a kind of hyper-resonance where we can access memories through our body, or we can encounter these other forms, these others, through our own body. That's kind of what I try to do in some of my dance work.
Yeah, yeah. And I'm sure you're aware of the work of, like, people who have put out that, you know, water holds memory. So if that's the case, if our bodies are, you know, 70-80% water, then obviously our bodies are holding memory all throughout them. And there's another quote here from you that I like. It says, one of the intentions driving my work is the retrieval of ways of knowing, of practices proper to the bodies of women, knowledge that has been suppressed, forbidden, and lost, but which I believe is recoverable through an active inquiry into the body's mysteries. I don't have a question about that. I just thought that quote was worth sharing because it does sort of talk to what we're talking about.
I mean, in that I was specifically talking about a person, actually an office, the female necromancers that Ezekiel is very angry at in the Bible. But, you know, all male and female bodies can both access memories. I don't think it's something that only women can do. But that was specifically talking about a female office and a female mystery. So, yeah.
Yeah. So let's bring the goddess back into this. You know, one thing I think worth noting here is something you also wrote. The nature of the goddess demands an embodied practice. The body as a repository of knowledge is comparable to myth. Thus, my approach has been to combine a physical praxis with a study of myth and narrative, a mythosomatic investigation, as they unlock each other's mysteries and disclose unforeseen vistas across their respective fields. As always, the work begins and ends with the body. Now, this pairs well with your dance practice. It pairs well with this entire conversation. So let's talk a bit more about your dance. You know, you practice buto, a Japanese form of dance theater. And I do want to describe that for everyone. But before we do, I'm wondering which came first in your life. And I think you may have answered that already. But did your understanding of how to best connect with or work with the goddess lead you to dance? Or was it through your dancing that you learned of the goddess?
Dancing first. Shortly after I started dancing, I connected with a Tibetan dakini called Kurukula. And of course, not at all in any kind of initiatic. I wasn't belonging to any Tibetan lineage, but I saw a picture of her and I just sort of froze and like all my energy went. So I worked like alone with her for a few years after I'd started dancing, shortly after I started dancing, and in meditation, like visualized meditation, when I was, just kind of after I started dancing, buto. And then later I met Peter, and after I met Peter, well, I met Peter after I'd had a vision of Babalon, and in which she said she would give me her lover and reveal a number of things to me. And I was just, I had no idea what she was talking about. And 3 months later, I met Peter. And he started giving me passages from The Red Goddess to read. It hadn't been published. We hadn't started Scarlet at that point, but he'd written it. And I realized from what I was reading that this was the goddess that I had seen. So at that point, I focused all my work around Babalon. I still honor Kurukula. Mm-hmm. She's very important too. I think it's about this retrieval of, I mean, it was, the work isn't there. The only work around Babalon had been a male work, and it's the same with the whole of Western magic, or even actually Eastern magic. If you look at Tantra or Taoism, almost all the practices are written and described from a male perspective. So there was nothing for me to work with. There was no material. The only material was the myths. So very important, like working with the Libra 49, with the Daughter of Fortitude as texts, with Revelation, and looking at the myths of the, like Inanna Ishtar, the Mesopotamia, the various manifestations of this goddess. So that's why I talk about like this mythosomatic approach. It's that in order to begin to understand what to do with my body to find this, I looked to the myths and questioned these things, or I looked to the words that she'd spoken. I do voice work with these things, so Libra 49 and the Daughter of Fortitude, trying to find her voice through these words that have come through us, even if they've come through like vessels like Jack Parsons, where there's a clearly problematic, but it's her voice still coming through at points, or supposed to be. So I'm trying to find the body that gives this voice and try to find what that awakens in my body by these kind of works. And through the myths, through these descriptions of her story, through to find ways to embody this, to work with the body. And then the body opens up understandings of the myths. So for instance, it was the work I did with the Salome dance and the decollation of flowers that enabled me to suddenly grasp what it meant to be the mother of harlots and the mother of abominations. Quite like, it's not simply she's given birth to them, it's that she's created them out of her body and through her body and nurtured these things and created, imprinted them. with her nature, her essence. So it's the body can, the work with the body gives an insight into text, and the text themselves give you leads or clues into like what to start looking at with the body. It's just a way to start developing a practice where there was no practice for women. I had to find a way to do it myself. And that was the necessity, was to find roots into this work.
Yeah. So, you know, I find the whole idea of dance or ritual dance to be, like, obviously it's self-empowering and it's also pretty erotic, or at least it can be. And it's obviously a way to connect with spirit, you know, to naturally elevate your own consciousness, maybe even induce a trance state, you know, very similar to intense meditation or deep breathing, perhaps. But yeah. I think dance is probably ultimately more, I guess, effective at doing that. And I don't know if you've heard me say this before, but I've said on this podcast a few times, I refer to dance as the original body language, you know, and I'm sure I'm not the only one who said that or thought that. But when it comes to Buto specifically, what are some of the characteristics of that? You know, we mentioned it was Japanese dance theater, but what all does that encompass?
Well, it's a lot of different things. When Hijikata was developing it in the 60s and 70s, he went through a lot of different approaches and styles, and it's very experimental, and he wasn't settled on one thing. So Buto itself is, before he even abandons the world, is already many things. And in the dancers that have taken it on since, it becomes many things. But for me, one of the most, I guess, idiosyncratic and interesting aspects of Buto is this methodology of working with images and putting, like, the imagistic side of it, where as a dancer, one works with images and placing them in the body, and it opens up the body to different ways of feeling and moving that don't come in straightforward dance. Often I look at dance, contemporary dance or whatever, and it can be very athletic. It can be absolutely stunning from a technical point of view, but the quality is absent for me, and this particular quality seems something very, very strong in Buto, and it's got a lot to do with this work with images. And I, in my own research, I relate that to Abby Warburg's work with the pathos fulmen, and these ideas that an image holds a lot of time, that it's a sort of it's a way of capturing the most, like, quintessential essence of an emotion or a moment. And in, like, because we can read these things very well, we see a gesture and we understand a lot about it. We understand the quality of emotion behind the gesture, and then that starts to bring a story in as well. And with Buto, you find images that evoke this kind of movement and gesture and expression in the body that I don't see being part of the sort of methodology of other dance forms. There's a lot more internal work, and not that I think that one should concentrate solely on that and exclude this sense that there is an audience or a world outside, but it's just that there's a stronger dynamic between the inner and the outer worlds in Buto, and this ability to externalize an inner world that one's constructed in the choreography, and hopefully, like, communicate, and more than just communicate. When I say communicate, I mean it in the way that Law, Colette Peignot, talks about communication as this heightened sacred sense where people come together and are united in a common experience. It sort of raises everybody's consciousness, not just the dancer, but everyone experiencing this. And this is why, like, I have a conflict with having videos of performances. On one hand, you need something for people to see, to say this happened, but the thing with performance is that you really have to be there. You really have to experience it. And that's what I like about it, that it is temporal, that it's temporary, that it's something that you break down these skin barriers with people, because you come together and you all feel at the same time the same thing. And that, to me, is magical. And alongside that, with the choreography and the inner work, this imaginative aspect, for me, this is a lot where the magic comes into Buto, where you can construct a ritual because you have, like, a very clear inner choreography that goes alongside the outer choreography as well.
So where do we see dance in general, like, as a ritual practice or as an art form? Like, where do we see that actually emerge in the human story? I know the Greeks wrote a lot about where it came from, but, I mean, how old is it?
I'd say dance is older than humans, because you see birds dancing and insects dancing and other species. So I think dance is pre-hominid. I think we were we became men already dancing, men and women. We became human already dancing. And that's another interesting aspect for me in terms of this gestural language. We can understand the body language of animals often. It's only scientists that put this, that come up with, occasionally I see a really stupid headline in New Scientist saying, scientists now believe animals feel emotion. So like, what? You mean you only just noticed that you can't tell that like the dog is sad or the donkey is bored or, you know, I mean, even like, I've seen spiders in my house with different characters, different personalities. It's clear that all of nature is unique and individual, and all of nature participates in this same corporeal language. So yes, dance is the oldest language, and it precedes the human language. And it's probably the basis for our human spoken language. There's very interesting work by, what's her name? What's her name, Peter? Oh. No. Oh, I've forgotten. This is terrible. I'm going to have to...
That's okay. That's okay.
Anyway, Maxine Sheets Johnson talks about her work a bit, and she's a linguist, and she... Oh, wait a minute. Hold on a second. I'm going to get her book.
Okay.
Mary LeCron Foster. Did you hear that?
Yeah.
Mary LeCron Foster. So she talks about like the basis of language coming out of the shapes we make with our body or with our mouth that create sounds that... then become language, so that there are like, I think 28 or something sort of base sounds or base words that she can trace to, that she traced to, like they were in common with all languages in the world. So before the culture keeps elaborating more and more and more and more, at base, our language is based on, first of all, what the body can do, what our throats do, what our mouths do, what our bodies do. And then the miracle of human culture is that we keep elaborating and creating new languages and variations on it. But this is fascinating, because for me, the dance is older. It's like if you watch cranes dancing, you're aware that it's not just something that they've been programmed to do in their genes. It's something they've learned as a culture. So you see like the cultures of animals, these things are passed on. It's not just humans that have this. We're not that special. We just have particularly strange culture because of what we've managed to do with being, you know, with our hands and things.
Well, do you think that maybe the first humans, when they started dancing, that they were mimicking the heavenly bodies at all? You know, that sort of cosmic dance up there?
I think that would have been one of the early ways of relating the movements, because everything is moving. But I also think that they would have been mimicking animals. There's a very interesting work by Jerome Lewis looking at mimicry and language in hunter-gatherer tribes. I forgot which one he was working with. But, you know, there's the hunter-gatherers that he was working with, they would be out and they could make the sounds of all the animals. And then they would come back and they would tell stories. And the stories were illustrated with like all these movements and gestures and sounds as well. So we have an extraordinary capacity for mimicry. And this is something that I think we really excel at as humans. And it turns into comedy. It turns into like, you know, buffooning and clowning. And this is also part of our heritage, as we're a species that has to cooperate. We can't. The Ayn Rand argument that, you know, every man for himself just doesn't stand up, because there's no way humans can survive without cooperation. We're a very expensive species because of our brain size. So cooperation is built around creating some sort of like commonality. And I think clowning as well as ritual is a way to create a common bond between people. So I think, yes, the mimicry is important in establishing these bonds and that sense of commonality, not only between people understanding and laughing and sharing an experience, but between all of nature. It is very interesting work by another member of the radical anthropology group, which Jerome Lewis is in, and it's Camilla Power has done, and Chris Knight. Interesting work looking at the relationship between menstruation and the origins of culture. And the fact that women menstruate and bleed together is a way to... And this is into Chris Knight's sex strike theory. I don't know if you've heard of. But this female solidarity is at the heart of like the creation of culture, because they need to cooperate together in order to raise children, because children are like, they are very time intensive and you need help getting food and looking after and raising them. So women create a solidarity, and that itself, you know, that female solidarity and creation of culture is what domesticates men. I think maybe we need a bit more of that now.
Yeah, I think I would agree with that for sure.
Yeah.
So this has been sort of a backwards interview because I want to wind down here talking about you. I think most folks would know you as the co-founder of Scarlet Imprint, an independent press founded in 2007, based in the UK, specializes in the occult. But yeah. I'm curious what your life was like before Scarlet Imprint, specifically as it relates to occult culture. Is this something you were introduced to as a child, or did it come later in life?
I had pretty strange experiences as a child. I was a strange child, but it wasn't overtly occult. I didn't even get involved in the occult until quite late in my mid-20s. And even then, it was more sort of the Eastern material I was drawn to and looking at, like tantric material, rather than the Western occult. I had no idea there were such things as practicing magicians. Yeah. And I remember walking into Treadwell's bookshop in Covent Garden and being, oh, there's like a Western occult. There are people who are witches and magicians and things. And it was completely like, I had no idea such a thing existed. So that aspect of it was late, but my occult experiences started very early. I just didn't have a framework, a Western framework to give it. And if anything, it belonged to a more intuitive and then Catholic kind of framework. When I came to England, I was 5 when I was brought to England and, you know, thrown into church and school. And my first sort of experience of church was like horror, but also when I became aware that this is the way things are, there is a God and he knows everything you're thinking. I just assumed that the only way to be was to like, well, the only point of life was therefore to become a saint. You know, it just seemed like logical that one would try to go as far as possible in this life. That was just the kind of, that's just in my nature to be extreme like that. But I didn't have any sense of occult practice in like of the Western occult until my mid-20s. Then I met Peter, and Peter sort of is responsible for my magical training in that sense. It's all been, you know, with the work I've done with Peter and Babalon, that's my background, Western magic.
Well, I know a lot of people who are fans of this podcast are also fans of Scarlet Imprint and what you guys do with these books. You know, this is a traditional art form, you know, the way you guys do this and is thus inherently magical, you know. So you actually refer to the process of your bookmaking as talismanic, right?
We used to, but less now because it's such a problematic term. But they are, we approach them in that way. We approach them that everything is congruent, that there is an intent behind every aspect of the book process as far as we can control it without actually making them ourselves. But yeah, the whole endeavor of Scarlet Imprint is a magical endeavor. Something we're trying to, we're just trying to change things. Just trying to create a, I guess we're kind of a heresy. I like to think of us as a kind of occult publishing heresy. Alternative, yeah. Asking questions, well, making other ideas for the way things can be. You know, initially it was, why are all occult books black?
That's a fair question, you know, in terms of the coloring, because I've wondered that myself. So did you guys study the, you know, the history of like fine book arts, or curious if you've drawn any inspiration in your bookmaking from anywhere?
Well, my personal inspirations were the books that Alfred Jarry, who wasn't an occultist exactly, he was a pataphysician, but I was very interested in his approach and that of Rémy Gourmand, who he worked with on one of his projects, a periodical called L'Imagier. I was very interested in that approach to publishing. It was all like, everything was very carefully chosen. It was the most ridiculous materials possible, the format, everything. So this was behind, for me, very much an inspiration. I know I can't talk about Crowley's work so much, but I know that Crowley's work informed Peter a lot. And other than that, I mean, when we started, we didn't know anything about it. We didn't have like, we hadn't studied the history of, you know, book binding, but we were both book lovers. We both had, you know, big libraries of books. And the thing is, for me, like even my paperback books, there were books that I carried with me and I still carry, you know, every time I go somewhere and I've got a bag, I've got like 3 books in my bag that even if I don't read them, they have to be with me. And they might just be scruffy old paperbacks, but they still have, you know, books, the physical book, it doesn't matter how pretty it is, it still has this presence, this being about it, which fascinates me. They become And as I've rescued or inherited or picked up quite a few secondhand books, and sometimes they have names written in them or dedications, and they have this history about them. There's something that passes through them in the hands that actually hold them. It's again this sensual thing that really interests me in what we do with our books, is that it's not just something you read. It's, you know, what paper you choose, because the light falls on different papers differently. And then, you know, how your eyes respond to this, and the touch of the cloth or the touch of the paper, the smell of it, the whole sensual experience of having a book, the way that a book is related to the human body, because when you're holding it, you have to hold it at a certain distance, and it's related to your personal geometry of your body. So for me, this is the part of the magic of it, and this contact, this holding of it, this reading and experiencing, this is what's sort of behind my interest in making books a certain way. And it's true for the paperbacks as much as the hardbacks, although there are more limitations on what you can do with a paperback, and we try to make them affordable and not, you know, we can't get too carried away with the paperbacks, because I just want people to be able to read the material as well if they can't afford the hardbacks. So a bit of pragmatism and a bit of like flight of imagination and and magical elements in both.
Yeah, I've always been drawn to books that are a bit experimental, both in content and in presentation. So I really do enjoy your guys' work for reason. And I am curious, though, you guys publish nonfiction, you publish poetry. Have you ever thought about doing some fiction?
If the right piece came along, but we haven't found it yet. Yes, I'm very interested. I think that I really love poetry. We both love poetry. And it's also that we have this sort of wish with Scarlett that we can change sometimes the way people expect a magical book to be, what they expect, what form they expect it to take. I'm not a big fan of books of instructions and, you know, rituals laid out, you know, do this, do this, do this, mm-hmm. and so on, because a ritual for me is like a dance or a choreography. It's something that you have to, the real part of it that works is often what you fill the bare bones of the structure with. I'm really interested in works that are more experimental, that, because I think magic should be out on that edge. I don't think it's really magic if you're staying in your comfort zone and you're not getting to that point where you encounter the other, whether it is a god or a daimon or a demon or an angel. You have to go beyond. And part of that going beyond is this expansion of the imagination and your going even beyond your own limits. So, yeah, that's why the poetry. and also, like, for example, the work we're doing with Ayes Lertas, that's just a picture book, just images that don't explain. They demand the viewer to engage with them and to find something, to pull something out of the person who's looking at it. So I'm very fond of books that don't give you everything, or don't even claim to give you everything, but actually ask something from the magician who's looking at them. It's kind of part of the way I think magic works. So I wanted our books to have that quality about them, as well as, you know, being informative. Some of our books are just informative books, historical, or these looking at different traditions. But yeah, even these books, we want them to have that sensual feeling where it stimulates these other parts of your, let's say, occulted body, that the occulted body is brought into the, is woken up by this material.
Definitely, yeah. And if I ever finish writing my novel or series of novels, I may send it your way just to see if you're interested. So.
Do so.
Definitely. The last thing I wanted to mention before we go here is that you are giving a presentation at Flambeau Noir in Portland, Oregon, April 27th through the 29th. I might mispronounce Colette's name here, but it's called The Passion of Colette. Is it Peignot?
Peignot.
So I was wondering if you could tell us a bit about her, you know, and what your presentation will be about.
Oh, like, it's a dance. It's I did a dance a couple of years ago in the University of Northampton called The Invocation of Colette Peignot. And this is like a sort of reworking of that, where I'm going to sort of go into a different aspect of this, of her story and of her personality that I wanted to bring out, so hence the passion. She was the lover of Bataille. She was a member of the Collège de Sociologie and of the secret society, SFR. She was a very important member of this group, but she's almost unknown, of course, because she's not the great man himself. And my initial desire when I made the invocation was to put her back in the world. And not just her, but her ideas because her ideas are very, very interesting. And I think her book's out of print and you can't even find it. I've looked. It's I've only seen it for like hundreds of pounds, and I will have to talk to the press to see if they can reprint it. But I would really like to see more discussion and awareness of her and her ideas, and as it relates to the work of Bataille and people like Michel Lewis, their friend, and Maurice Blanchot, because I think it's very important. She's the feminine perspective that's missing from their work. And my own experience also has been, like, when we started publishing, I remember being at launch parties and things, and people would congratulate Peter on his latest book, and they would completely blank me, like I didn't exist. So I have this experience of being a woman, the assumption that, oh, you're just like, you're just the eye candy on the arm of the magician. You're just the scarlet woman, in this terrible kind of way that it denies your importance or your thought or your experience, your ability to think for yourself. And it was women as much as men that also did this. It's not something I'm just going to put on men here. It was just this assumption that men do think and are, and women are somehow on the side. So for me to bring Colette into the kind of conversation again and to raise awareness of her was also for me a way to try and inspire other women, younger women, to come forward and to produce work and to speak up and to just, and for men and women to recognize that the work of women is as important as the work of men. In fact, I think many of Colette's ideas were inspiring to Bataille, and he drew from her thought as much as anything else. So it was just kind of redressing this balance and bringing this feminine back, and an extraordinary woman too. I mean, an absolutely fascinating individual who I became quite obsessed with for a while. I mean, I would say, I said in a piece I wrote on her, like, she obsessed me. It felt very much like she wouldn't let me sleep for a few months. She was like keeping stirring my consciousness and troubling me. And I felt this presence, you know, moving me to do something, to bring her through again. So again, I felt the need to revisit that because she started talking to me again and I wanted to tell another aspect. I don't know what happens in these performances in a way, because there's always an absolute unknown with dance. It's not like a book. You write it and you finish it, and at some point you've got to say it's not mine anymore. You either give it to someone else to edit or publish, and it's your part of it's done. And the words belong to someone else. With a dance, it's like I don't know what happens until I do it, and it never really belongs to me. It just comes through me. The movement is there, and I just want people to be able to participate in that experience, to be part of that communication. And what they get from it, I don't know, but it would be interesting if it brings some of this presence, the feminine, back into the forefront again.
I found a couple stories now of specifically French women authors and intellectuals that their work is fascinating, but it's also heavily unknown and suppressed on some level. So it's nice that you have brought her at least back into prominence on some level. And well,
I don't know if anyone pays any attention to me, actually. Well, I just or look up this material. I sometimes wonder, but if one or two people hear it and get curious and start researching and reading, and also it makes other women, it catches light, you know, and they want to write and they want to express. And I mean, for example, I listened to your talk with Katie Bohink recently, and that was I really love her work, and I really loved listening to her talk. And I think we all want more women writing and experimenting with these forms. Definitely.
And just one more little synchronicity about Colette. She died November 7th, 1938. I was born November 7th, 1983. So, pretty interesting numerical synchronicity there, for sure. So,
interesting.
Yeah, definitely. So that, I think, is a good place to wrap up. Please do tell people, I mean, obviously, scarletimprint.com is the place to find all the books. Where can people find more of your work specifically, though?
My work specifically is, my dance work is on alkistisdimech.com, and I've got a few essays on Scarlet Imprint that aren't on my website. My website's just really focused on my dance work at the moment, so not so much the overtly occult material, but it is. And that's alkistisdimech.com. I'm not very big on social media, but yeah, the links are there if anyone's interested to follow what I'm doing.
I know we quoted some of your essays throughout this, so I'll link to all those and the other websites too for sure. So Kika, thanks for being here. Yeah. I really do appreciate your time.
Yeah, I'm Kika.
Yeah.
Thanks, Ryan.
All right. Hey, thank you so much. And there you have it. My thanks again to Alkistis Dimech. Check out her work at her website, linked in the show notes, along with all the essays that were quoted throughout the conversation here. And if you're in the Portland, Oregon area this weekend, check out Alkistis at the Flambeau Noir Conference. I believe tickets are still available, and that is also linked in the show notes. And I'll tell you, this may be one of my favorite episodes. We turned a 140-character tweet into a hell of an hour-long conversation about Babalon and the feminine, ritual dance, the occulted body, and the art of bookmaking. Quite a few of my favorite things there. And in addition, Alkistis is such a well-spoken, down-to-earth, and humble person, and her passion for her art and her craft is second to none, and I think that really shone through here. And speaking of that shine, new patrons gave us some over at Patreon. My thanks to Abby and Daniel for getting in on the campaign and showing their support. Daniel actually came in at the $20 a month level and became an official executive producer of the show. Much love and gratitude to you both. Of course, you too can join them as patrons at patreon.com/occulture. That's the only way to keep this show going, and I really have no idea how long I'll be able to keep doing this. It's a lot of time and energy and, of course, money to keep this online. It's not free to produce, and I don't just say this for myself. All the podcasters you enjoy are investing a lot of themselves and their own resources into this. So even if you don't want to support me, please do consider supporting others. There's a lot of good podcasts out there these days, and why not show the people producing them that you find their work worthwhile and want it to continue? You know, I actually saw a YouTube comment the other day on a recent episode from a podcast I listened to, and the commenter was demanding that the guest of the podcast start his own YouTube channel because they wanted to know all the information from the book he'd published, but felt that they shouldn't have to buy the book in order to get the information. And while I see the point, I mean, information should be free, writing is fucking hard. And again, a lot of time and energy and money goes into that. The least you can do after you hear someone you enjoy on a podcast is support their work, especially if you want the information that's in a book they wrote. And if you don't want to pay for it, well, do something about capitalism then. Anyway, slightly triggered there, as the neo-libs want you to say. But that's it for me this time. Until next time, you've just been initiated into a culture. I am Ryan Peverly, reminding you to love yourself, think for yourself, and question authority.
This cassette.